काइंडली आंसर दिस क्वेश्चन. द मोस्ट कॉमन कॉज ऑफ ग्रॉस हिमेचुरिया इन अ पेशेंट मोर देन 50 इयर्स ऑफ एज इज. ओपन योर माइक एंड आंसर द क्वेश्चन. द ऑप्शन आर रीनल कैलाई इन्फेक्शन, सी ए ब्लैडर, बीपीएच एंड और ट्रॉमा.
सी ए ब्लैडर.
सी ए ब्लैडर.
प्लीज ओपन योर माइक एंड आंसर द क्वेश्चन. द मोस्ट कॉमन कॉज ऑफ ग्रॉस मैच्यूरिया. दिस इज वेरी सिंपल क्वेश्चन डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम द कैंपबेल रिव्यूज.
सर साउंड नॉट कमिंग सर.
जस्ट वेट फॉर अ व्हाइल, आई एम कॉलिंग देम.
So is it clear from here, till here? I'm audible now. Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible now.
Yes, boss.
Okay. So the cause of different hematuria, the initial, entire, and terminal hematurias are the prostatic, urethra, or so the when they whenever the hematuria is associated with pain. It is associated with the clots, okay? And the vermiform clots suggestive of upper tract, while the cuboidal clots suggestive of bladder etiology. Cuboidal clots also known as amorphous clot. Okay. Now the second question: which of the following is the typical lower urinary tract symptom associated with benign prostatic hyperplasia? Except, answer it.
D. Dysuria.
It is D. Dysuria. Why it is D. Dysuria?
Storage symptom, sir.
No, voiding. It is not not voiding. What do you mean by the dysuria? Dysuria is nothing but a painful urination. Okay, and this painful urination is mainly due to the inflammation of the bladder. Okay, and what do you mean by strangury? Anyone? Strangury. Strangury is a sharp stabbing pain at the end of the micturition. Okay, the sharp stabbing pain at the end of the micturition is known as strangury. And in that, when it is seen, the strangury is seen, it is seen in the condition of cystitis. Cystitis is nothing but an inflammation of the bladder. Okay, so that when they are, and this strangury due to the final contraction, it is seen that at the end of the micturition there is a stabbing pain. Okay. Okay, and this pain is due to the final contraction of the inflamed bladder, which is the inflamed bladder is known as cystitis. Okay, but what are the different obstructive and irritative LUTS? LUTS is nothing but the lower urinary tract symptoms. The obstructive LUTS constitutes when there is some obstruction within the passage of the urine. Okay, so the obstructive LUTS constitutes straining, incomplete emptying, weak stream, and intermittency. Okay, so and the irritative LUTS contain the FUN. What is FUN? The frequency, urgency, and nocturia. The when we said it is a frequency, when the patient has to pass urine more than 6 times a day. Okay, and when we said nocturia, anyone? We'll discuss this thing in the last class. Nocturia.
More than once in the night time.
Okay, patient. More than one is 9 times. Good. It is suggestive of nocturia. And when it is suggestive of significant nocturia, when passes more than 2 times. Okay, so remember, the LUTS can be divided into the obstructive and the irritative part. Obstructive part constitutes incomplete emptying, straining, weak stream, intermittency. Okay, and what does irritative? It is frequency, urgency, nocturia. These 7 variables. Okay, we measure these 7 variables, and through these 7 variables, we get the AUA, that is the American Urology Association symptom score. Okay, and what is IPSS score? Okay, IPSS score is AUA score plus quality of life score. This is an important MCQ. Okay, so remember it. And these also one of the important MCQ, remember it. Okay, so and this IPSS score is divided into the 3 parts, mild, moderate, and severe. Okay, so the mild part is from 0 to 7. Okay, 8 to 19 is moderate, and 20 to 35 is severe. Okay, so this is all about the LUTS part. Okay, now the next question: the most likely cause of continuous incontinence. If anybody having any doubt in between, please ask. Okay, most likely cause of continuous incontinence is simple question. Please give the answer.
Vesicovaginal fistulas.
Yeah, it is very simple question. It is answer is D. Okay, so what do you mean by the incontinence? Incontinence is nothing but an involuntary passage of urine. Okay, the patient doesn't know that the urine passed out. So there are different kind of incontinence. It may be a stress incontinence. Stress incontinence seen in the conditions like sphincteric weakness. Intrinsic sphincteric weakness conditions mainly seen in the females. Okay, so the stress incontinence seen in these conditions, urge incontinence seen in the condition of overactive bladder. These two conditions we'll discuss. We were discussing in the last class of urodynamic that these conditions seen in the condition of overactive bladder. When these two conditions mix, it is known as mixed urinary incontinence. Okay, now the continuous incontinence. Okay, the passage of the urine continuously leaked out from the patient. Okay, and there is an it is independent of the urge to urinate. Okay, what happened in the stress urinary incontinence? There is an increase in intra-abdominal pressure. Okay, what is happened in the urge incontinence? There is a urge to go to the toilet, and then the urine the incontinence occur. But in the continuous incontinence, there is no increase in intra-abdominal pressure and there is no urge. Okay, seen in the condition of vesico-vaginal fistula. Now tell me the another important cause of continuous
ectopic ureter.
Yeah, it is a ectopic ureter. Very good. It is a ectopic ureter. Okay, seen in the conditions, seen in the which condition? The duplicate ureters, okay, in with the upper pole. Okay, the upper pole is medial and ectopic, okay, and lying down. Okay, so that is ectopic ureters, and in these condition also the continuous incontinence seen. Condition in which the overflow incontinence is seen. Overflow incontinence is also not known as paradoxical incontinence, seen in the patient of chronic bladder outlet obstructions. Okay, why it is known as paradoxical? Because these patients have the prolonged history of bladder outlet obstruction, and due to gradual progression, patient not aware of their obstructive symptom. Okay, so these patient having overflow incontinence. And when there is a pseudo incontinence, actually the patient having no urinary incontinence, but they feel that the patient having incontinence, that is known as pseudo incontinence, seen in the condition of chronic vaginal discharge and the patient having severe labial fusion. Okay, functional incontinence. Functional incontinence is a condition in which the patient is anatomically and physiologically normal, but the patient is unable to move to go to the toilet, so that the patient, the seen in the patient who are bedridden, all the elderly patients. Okay, now there is another type of incontinence, enuresis. Okay, enuresis is also considered a type of incontinence. Okay, now tell me, up to what age we consider the normal urinary, and enuresis is nothing but a urinary incontinence during sleep. Okay, so up to what age we consider enuresis is a normal?
5 years.
Are you sure? 5 years?
Yes, sir. It can be present up to 12 years in 1% patient.
No. Listen. Remember, it is given in the Campbell in two places. It is given either it is 3 years of age, it is considered normal, and in one place it is given 4 years, it is normal. Okay, so in my opinion, if the question came to you regarding this, mark it 4 years. Okay, make it very clear in your mind. Remove this doubt. Make it 4 years. Okay, second thing, what you tell me is that it is persist up to 15% up to 5 years. Okay, and yes, and in 1% up to 15 years. Okay, this is what is the prevalence of enuresis at 5 years of age. Okay, it is not that is it normal up to 5 years of age. It is normal up to 4 years of age, but it is seen in 15% of patient at 5 years of age. Okay, and 1% up to 15 years of age, and it can be a primary or secondary, which we discuss later in the enuresis part. Okay, now tell me what is the most common cause of cloudy urine? Tell me, very simple question. What are the okay, good. What are the different cause? How we differentiate phosphaturia? By
acidic acid.
Yeah, by acidifying the urine with acetic acid. Okay, when we acidified the urine with acetic acid, the urine becomes completely clear. It is very common. Okay, now what are the different causes other than the phosphaturia of cloudy urine? Cloudy urine is nothing. What?
Oxaluria, chyluria,
proteinuria.
More appropriately, it is a chyluria. Chyluria can be due to the lipiduria, hyperoxaluria, or hyperuricosuria. Okay, so the three causes of cloudy urine is phosphaturia. Second is chyluria. This chyluria is due to the hyperoxaluria or lipiduria, and another is pyuria. Okay, so this is very simple. You all can opt this question very easily. But what is important for MCQ nowadays, the new question is asked, what is the cause of purple bag urine?
Mitomycin.
Not mitomycin. Anyone? So this purple bag urine seen in the patient of UTI, okay, and patient having chronic catheter in situ, okay. When the patient having chronic catheter and that patient having UTI, in these patient, what happened? The tryptophan. It is due to tryptophan metabolism. Okay, the tryptophan is converted into the indole. So these indole compounds give the purple color to the urine. Okay, this is a one of the emerging question for a MCQ. Remember it. Okay. And now tell me what is the cause of cola colored urine? This is easy to answer. Cola colored urine is due to
hemoglobin, myoglobin.
Cola colored urine is commonly due to what? Simple of question. It is suggestive of glomerular bleeding. Okay, cola colored urine. It is mentioned somewhere in your general surgery books that cola colored urine is seen in the cases of myoglobin urea also. But in for urology part, if there is no option of myoglobin urea, okay, then market glomerular bleeding. Okay, so this is all about cloudy urine and different colors of the urine. Now tell me, what is the compound responsible for the normal yellow color of the urine? See, easy, give fast answer, please. It is due to the urochrome pigment. Okay, remember, kindly mark, write these points in your notebook. Okay, right now only. Okay, so the urochrome pigment gives the normal yellow color urine of the. Now tell me what is the normal urine osmolarity?
50 to 1200.
Yeah, it is 50 to 1200. What is the normal? Okay, what is the normal specific gravity? Remember, the specific gravity of the urine is 1.001 to 1.005, and the osmolarity is 50 to 1200. This is direct MCQ based on facts. And what is normal pH? It is 5.5 to 6.5. Okay. Now both these two conditions suggestive of what? The hydration status of the patients. Okay. And when, if the option is given, which of the following suggestive of hydration of the status more significantly? One option is specific gravity, second option is osmolality, third option is pH. Okay, so what is the right answer? Most significantly is the osmolality. Okay, osmolality is most commonly indicator of renal function and hydration. Okay, now the condition, not to remember each and every point, just remember the condition in which the water intake is increases. Okay, that in that condition the specific gravity and the osmolality is decreases. Water increases. Okay, water increases water is resulting into a decrease osmolality or specific gravity. So the condition in which water increases is, first is diabetes insipidus. Okay, diabetes insipidus, patient having on diuretics. Okay, so the increased kidney, increased water to the kidneys. Okay, the patient having increased fluid intake. Okay, or condition causing decreased renal concentratic ability. Okay, and the condition in which the water is decreasing in the body, that causes increase in specific gravity or increase in osmolality, like condition of having dehydration. Okay, antidiuretic hormones, important. The important for MCQ point of view. This is an important MCQ. Iodinated compounds. Iodinated, most specifically iodinated contrast. Okay, what does it cause? It decreases water. Okay, and it increases. Remember this important point. Increases what? Osmolarity or specific gravity. Okay, are you getting my point?
Yes.
Okay, now next question. Hematuria distinguished from hemoglobin urea and myoglobin urea by? Very simple question, we already discussed.
Microscopic
presence.
Oh yeah, so how we diagnose hematuria? Diagnostics of hematuria, first we do what? This dipstick testing. Okay, and followed by microscopic examination. Now what are the different question? The sensitivity of the dipstick testing is, anyone?
90%.
More than 90%. Okay. It's a sensitivity. Remember this important point. Okay. Now, from lipstick, it is not able to differentiate these three conditions. Okay. These three conditions is not able to differentiate these three. Why? Because how we identify the color of in the lipstick? What is a compound present which react with lipstick? In the hemoglobin, what is present?
Peroxidase.
Yeah. So in the hemoglobin, there is a peroxidase is present. Okay. The peroxidase react with this is a lipstick, there is an indicator. In indicator, what is present? This is also the important MCQ. This is also an important MCQ. And this is also important MCQ. There is a chromogen indicator. Okay. Remember this point. There is a chromogen indicator on the lipstick. Okay. And when the peroxidase reacted with this chromogen indicator, because the hemoglobin is present in all these three, hematuria, hemoglobin, or myoglobin is there. Okay. So the peroxidase react with chromogen indicator and give the color. Okay. According to the degree and amount of oxidation. So it is does not differentiate between these three conditions. So for differentiation, we use microscopic presence of erythrocytes or RBCs. Okay. And also remember the hematuria can be nephrologic origin or the urological origin. Okay. Most commonly important to remember that in the nephrological origin hematuria, the proteinuria is usually more than 300 milligram per deciliter and it is associated with the casts. Okay. So, and there's the RBCs also. So we evaluate the RBCs. Okay. First we confirm that there is a hematuria. Hematuria suggestive of more than 3 RBC per high power field. Okay. Now we differentiate between it. Either it is a nephrological or urological. Okay. So in the nephrological, if the cause is nephrological cause, it is due to glomerular or tubulointestinal disease, there is a more than 3 milligram per deciliter urine, also protein, sorry, and there is a RBC cast is present. And it is important that in the microscopic examination, the shape of the RBC is dysmorphic if the cause is glomerular origin and round, okay, if there is tubulointestinal origin. Okay, and important that in the tubulointestinal origin hematuria, there is a no RBC cast. Okay, and these ground cells is known as ghost cells. So the important MCQ, in which condition ghost cells are present? Okay, the ghost cells are present in the cases of tubulointestinal hematuria, in which there is a round is RBC and there is a no hemoglobin. Okay, no hemoglobin. These are round RBC with lacking hemoglobin. Okay, this is important MCQ. Another important MCQ, in which condition dysmorphic RBC is seen? Most common cause of glomerular origin of hematuria is IgA nephropathy. Okay, this is another important question. So remember these important points. So can we proceed further? If anybody having any doubt, please let me know. Okay, now tell me the transient proteinuria may be due to the all of the following except.
Urethroscopy.
Yeah. So what do you mean the transient proteinuria? It's a proteinuria which remains for some time and usually seen after the few conditions. Okay. So that the proteinuria is divided on the basis of timing into three parts: intermittent, persistent, and transient. Okay. So the transient is only present for some time. It is seen in the condition of fever, exercise, emotional stress, and congestive heart failures. Okay. And when we repeat analysis of the urine, there is a no proteinuria. Okay. And if it is still proteinuria, we consider it as a persistent proteinuria. Then the intermittent hematuria. Intermittent hematuria, it is also known as orthostatic proteinuria, when the proteinuria is related to the upright position. Okay. Now, if after some time, if it is not related to the protein, it is not related to the position, we consider it is also a persistent proteinuria. Now, when if the patient having persistent proteinuria, how we differentiate between different types of persistent protein urea. We measure the amount of protein in a urine, for which we, how we measure, we give 24 hour urine. We ask the patient,
no way, sir.
Sir, screen is frozen.
Sir, screen is hangout, sir.
Just wait for a while.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible.
So, till what I am audible to you? Till what part?
Yes, sir. From slide, sir. After the slide, discuss.
Sir, persistent part, you were discussing.
Okay, so the in the persistent part, remember, it is most common cause. The important MCQ is this: glomerular protein urea is the most important cause of the persistent protein urea, in which the amount is more than 200 milligrams. If it is less than 2000 milligrams, then either it is a normal protein, we do the electrophoresis and get the type of protein, okay. And if it is the normal protein, then the cause is tubulointestinal. Otherwise, if it is the abnormal protein, then it is considered overflow proteinuria. Overflow proteinuria, as the name suggests, the overflow proteinuria is due to the overproduction of some
no audio, sir.
So the patient having these risk factor, we can proceed with the algorithm of the asymptomatic hematuria, that is a UDCT urogram, only CT urogram and cystoscopy with RFT. Okay, and the patient having symptomatic or gross hematuria, we proceed with the three C's, that is cystoscopy, cytology, and CT urogram. This is very important. Remember it. Okay, this will provide to you after the class. Okay, now give this answer. Am I audible?
Acral.